Evening, everybody. So I'm going to present on our half-year results to the 31st of December 2021, and we're very pleased with those half-year results. I'll just pick up on some highlights to start with, and I'll come back to these through the presentation. So we're making very, very good progress on the strategy that we set out in September of 2021. All of the key metrics are up in the period. You can see on the slide there, profit is up, operating margin is up, and importantly, our interim dividend is up. We made an acquisition in the period in October, which is integrating very, very well. I'll come back to that in a moment. We're continuing to focus on the core disciplines of the business. That's helping us to manage inflation effectively at the moment, which is important. Our order book is very strong. Our pipeline is also very, very good behind the order book. So the number of work that we're bidding and tendering on at the moment. And so we're well on track for our targets that we've set out through to June 2026. So to come in a little bit more detail on the half-year performance, you can see we had controlled revenue growth up 10% in the period. That was up in both our building division and, importantly, in our infrastructure division, driven by our water business. Importantly, the margin also improved in both divisions. And then what that demonstrates is good underlying contract performance across the whole of the business. We did incur some exceptional costs in the period. These were related to strategic investments in two things. One, the acquisition that we made in October. And secondly, an updated cloud-based finance and commercial system. Historically, we would have capitalized those costs. We're no longer allowed to, so we've taken those through as one-off costs. And our low tax rate means that our profit before tax, £7.1 million, translated into a £6.5 million profit after tax and an earnings per share of 5.9p. And equally as important as the really good performance in the period is our strong balance sheet. So just to remind those of you who've heard me present before, and to those who are new to Galliford Try, we have no debt, we have no pension schemes to fund. And our balance sheet has, on average at the month ends, £180 million of cash in the bank, £211 million at the year end. And importantly, we also have improved our supplier payment performance again in the period. We now take on average just 25 days to pay our suppliers, and 98% of invoices are paid within 60 days. I'll come back to why that's important in a moment. As well as the cash balance, we have £48 million worth of PFI, PPP investments on the balance sheet, and those generated £2 million of interest income in the half year, so an annualized interest income of around £4 million from those assets. And so this balance sheet gives us a real platform to grow the business. So how do we use that balance sheet? Well, I guess there's a few things I just want to run through on the slide here. So firstly, the balance sheet supports our operational requirements, supports the delivery of our strategy. So a strong balance sheet, very important for our clients. And there's examples of us being invited to negotiate for work because of our strong balance sheet. Our balance sheet is equally important for our supply chain. They want to make sure that they will get paid and that they can run sustainable businesses themselves. That's important for us to attract the best supply chain to work for Galliford Try. And it also enables us to react to opportunities as they come up, enables us to look for bolt-on acquisitions if necessary, and it allows us to invest in the business, in our digital capabilities, in our people and so on. So really important in supporting the strategy. It's also very important in helping to mitigate any adverse market conditions that may arise in the future and for us to maintain the disciplines of the business. So to put it simply, we won't take the wrong contracts into the business just to generate short-term cash flow. There's no need to do that because we've got a strong balance sheet. It means we can make the right long-term decisions for the business. Strong balance sheet also allows us to pay a regular and sustainable dividend to our shareholders. We've improved our dividend policy. I'll come onto that again on the next slide. And our strong balance sheet also means that during the strategy period, when we have excess cash on the balance sheet, then we will be able to look to return that excess cash to shareholders. So as I've said, pulling all this together has allowed us to declare an interim dividend of 2.2 pence. That's 83% higher than the same period last year. And as I've said, we've improved our dividend policy. We had previously a dividend cover range of 2 to 2.5 times cover. We've improved that and simplified that to a straight 2 times cover. So what that means is we'll pay 50% of our earnings back to shareholders as dividends each year. So that's the results in the period. And I just want to look to the future and remind you of our strategy through to 2026 that we set out in September of last year. You can see the strategy on the slide there. It's very straightforward to build the buildings and infrastructure that the country needs in a socially responsible way. There's various strands to that. On the top left there, you can see we focus on a progressive culture. That means investing in our people, investing in strong health and safety processes and culture. On the bottom left there, it's about delivering our products in a socially responsible way. That's about low carbon. That's about increasing social value. So using local supply chain, local labor, and so on. On the top right, you can see it's about investing in quality and innovation. That's working with our clients to improve quality. It's working with our supply chain to help them deliver improved quality as well. And putting that together on the bottom right, you can see what that will generate is sustainable financial returns for our shareholders. So that's the strategy. This slide gives you a little bit of detail about how we're going to deliver growth and growth of revenue from 1.1 billion last financial year to about 1.6 billion in 2026, and importantly, margin improvement from 2% to 3%. And it's worth being very clear that revenue growth is there because the market is there to support the business in growing its revenue. But what our real focus is on risk management, it's on margin, and it's on bottom line profitable growth. So there's two main ways that we're going to grow the business. The first is through doing more of what we already do, so our existing markets, doing more with our existing customers. And secondly, to move into what we call adjacent markets. So these are markets that we know well, but they're just, if you like, a step along the value chain from where we currently operate. And maybe if I give you a couple of examples. So one is in the private rented space. We already construct a lot of private rented apartments. We're starting to move more into the development phase, which is a higher margin part of the process. Secondly, actually, it links into the previous presentation. We're looking to move our facilities management business into the green retrofit space. So this is taking existing buildings and making them more carbon efficient, so more operational carbon efficient, so in terms of reducing the carbon footprint in use. And that's about things like changing boilers to air source heat pumps, it's about changing ventilation systems and so on. And thirdly, in the water business, it's about moving from the CapEx, the building environment, into the asset maintenance and asset optimization space. And during the period, I've mentioned it a couple of times, we acquired the water business of NMCN. NMCN had unfortunately fallen into administration. We were able to buy the water part of that business from the administrators for a headline consideration of £1 million. And this acquisition is completely aligned to the strategy I've just set out. So firstly, it gave us real complementary geographic opportunities. So it worked with customers in the water space, which different customers, different geographic regions to our previous water business. So that's, if you like, more of the existing markets. Secondly, this gave us some additional capabilities in design and process management, in offsite build, and in motor control panels, which are the things which run the water treatment works around the country. And that's the adjacent market part of the strategy, which I spoke about a moment ago. And of course, the acquisition gave us nearly 900 excellent people who fitted in terms of cultural and values. Cultural values have fitted really well into the Galliford Try family. So this is a really excellent acquisition for the business. We were able to transact because of our balance sheet. It gave us the agility to move very quickly, to work with the company to buy that part of the business out. And that will really help us to grow our infrastructure business, both in terms of our existing markets and those additional capabilities. So I've said that the growth of the market is there to support our growth agenda. This slide just gives you some of the drivers of that market growth, in particular, levelling up, decarbonisation, that investment in the UK economic and social infrastructure. And the drivers of the market are very strong in the sectors that we operate in. So just to give you an idea, 90% of our work is in the public and regulated sector. So you can see that these big macro drivers really drive the markets that we operate in. And that we can see a really good pipeline of work coming through from government and from the regulated sector in response to those market drivers. And that is translating into a really excellent quality order book. So at the end of December, our order book was £3.4 billion. You can see the constituent parts on the slide. But what's more important, what's really critical, is the quality of the contracts and the quality of the work within that order book. It's all supportive of our margin improvement targets. You can see 95% of the work is secured already for this financial year. Probably more importantly, I've got 81% secured for the financial year through to June 2023. 87% of that is through frameworks, so established terms and conditions. We understand the way that we'll be going to market. 93% of that is with repeat customers. So those are just some indications of the quality of the order book. It means that nobody in the business has to go out and chase the wrong kind of work. And that quality order book allows the business to really continue to focus on risk management. This is really important in the construction sector, both in tendering and bidding, and also in the way that we manage construction projects when they're on site and on the ground. Those of you who saw the previous presentation will have seen this slide in September. This still applies. And it's probably more important at the moment, given the inflationary environment that we're operating in at the moment. And I thought it's maybe just worth touching on how we manage inflation across the business. And I suppose there's a few things here to just pull out. So the first is making sure we price our projects properly. So we price with current pricing. We price building in allowances into all of our jobs for future inflation. So what that means is, you know, if we've priced in 4% inflation, inflation's running at 6%, it's only that difference which is the element that we need to manage with our clients. We then also make sure that we procure early. That means locking in the prices of materials for a job. It means guaranteeing availability of those materials, which is equally as important. And we engage really closely with the supply chain. And that comes back to why it's so important that we pay our supply chain promptly, which is the message I talked about with the strong balance sheet. So putting together all of this, the form of the contract, the way that we're procuring out with our supply chain, the way we procure materials, the way we build in risk allowances, means that we've been able to manage inflation through the period. And I can tell you there's been no overall impact on trading in the period up to December, and we've not had to adjust our targets, our forward targets either. So just going back to that strategy slide that I set out earlier on, importantly, we've got annual measures for lots of items in each of these quadrants of the strategy. So we don't just focus on the financials, we focus very heavily on other measures as well. And importantly, these measures are sewn in. So we have a single strategy linking these ESG metrics with our financial strategy. So for us, it's really important. This is kind of two sides of the same coin. You can't distract or detach the ESG metrics, the way we want to run the business, from the sustainable financial returns that we're looking to generate. And just to pull a couple of statistics out from this slide, our accident frequency rate, 0.07, that's very good in the industry. It compares very favorably against Build UK, against industry averages. Of course, our objective is to get that down to zero. We don't want anybody to go home harmed on any of our sites, but that's clearly a long-term journey. We're investing very heavily in early careers. 6.2% of our staff are in early careers, so graduate programs, traineeships, apprenticeships, and we've committed to always having more than 5% of staff in early careers programs. And you can see on the bottom left there, we've got a score 41.4 on the considerate constructions scheme. That again is above industry average. So, and you can see these sorts of measures are really important in driving, making sure we get the right people into the business, work in the right way with our clients. And these are the things which will help us drive those sustainable financial returns. And the financial returns that we're looking to generate, you can see on the slide there in the middle column, are our financial targets through to 2026, growing the operating margin to 3%, growing our revenue towards £1.6 billion from £1.1 billion at the end in the full year to June 2021, to be cash generative at an operating cash level, and at the time to pay a dividend with a cover of 2 to 2.5 times. And you can see we've made in the half year to December 2021 progress on all of these targets. The margin was improved to 2.2%, revenue improved to 10%, improved up 10%. We had an operating cash inflow, and our interim dividend was up 83% with that improved policy of 2 times annual cover going forwards. So in summary, we're really pleased with the performance in the half year. We've got an excellent balance sheet, an excellent position in terms of our order book, and a really good pipeline of work behind that we're working on, that we're tendering on at the moment, driven by those market fundamentals. And so you put all of that together, and as a business, we're very, very confident in the outlook as we look forward, both for this financial year and through the strategy period to 2026. And so with that, Sarah, I'm very happy to take any questions.
Do you know what? So there's been lots of takeaways for me from this presentation, but my favourite slide had to be slide 13, how you were controlling inflation. And I'm sure that when tonight's event is put up as a video tomorrow, that your competitors will be freeze framing slide 13, because it looks as though you've set a gold standard for controlling inflation. But is inflation out of control?
No, it's not out of control, but it certainly has been higher than we've seen for a long period of time. And I should say, Sarah, you know, we've been able to manage inflation with no overall impact on the business. That is down to, as much as the processes and procedures that I talked through, it's down to the quality of the people we've got. They've been working really hard day in, day out to make sure we can manage this on a site-by-site basis. So we saw inflation, you know, spike obviously last year. We've seen, you know, inflation is high and will continue to be high for a period of time. So what that means is that we need to make sure that we're pricing our jobs, we're using current pricing when we're going to the market, that we make sure our clients understand. You know, a lot of the time, so what's happening is when we give a price to a client, that price, which may have been open for 3 months previously, is maybe open for a month now, because, you know, actually we can only kind of fix our prices for a shorter period of time because our supply chain has a shorter visibility of their own costs. So it's about working really closely with the supply chain, working really closely with our clients and making sure we can manage that through the business.
It's about being canny as well, I suppose, because you were very proud of your strong balance sheet. And I was a bit concerned that those inflationary pressures would eat into that strong balance sheet. However, as you told us, the strong balance sheet is important. It reassures the client. It reassures the contractors. It reassures potential acquisitions, which we'll come on to. And you won't take the wrong contract. So you don't want to destroy value in pursuit of, right, you know, quick outcomes, as it were. So you've made an acquisition and it's bedding in. That strong balance sheet, obviously we love our dividends, but we also like a good potential acquisition. So in terms of buying, purchasing, buying and building, is there a decent pipeline? Are you having good conversations at the moment with potentials?
So there's kind of two things, Sarah. So firstly, our strategy, our growth strategy, our margin improvement strategy, that doesn't rely on acquisitions. So we're not having to acquire things in order to meet the targets that we've set out. But where there are bolt-on acquisitions which can accelerate that strategy, which can allow us to hit those targets earlier, which can if you like, you know, add more to it, then of course we look at those, but we look at them through the lens of the strategy that we've set out. So we're not, you know, just going to buy something because something happens to be available. So the NMC acquisition is a great example. We'd set out our strategy in terms of how we wanted to grow the water business anyway, and how we wanted to move into additional adjacent markets around the capital asset optimization, capital maintenance in the water sector. And then the NMCN acquisition, which came to us, you know, only 6 weeks or so after we'd published the strategy, of course, fitted both of those criteria perfectly. So, but we'll make sure we look at acquisitions and potential bolt-ons through the lens that we've set out in terms of how we want to make sure we run the business. So we're not going to do anything which puts the business out of kilter, which upsets the balance. But of course, there may well be further opportunities to do acquisitions as we go forward, and we're very open to looking at those kind of bolt-ons.
ESG. So you've appointed the head of environmental this month. The word sustainability is on most of the slides. ESG, though, it's expensive. We're all on that journey to 2030 for net zero neutrality. But to do so, we have to change our fleet, electric vehicles. We have to change the way that we look after our staff and the communities in which we work. ESG is expensive. It's costly. I'm just thinking about the payback. How quickly can you get paid back for the investment that you're making into ESG now?
So, I mean, I have to say, my start point is it's more expensive not to focus on these things, Sarah. If we don't focus on these things, we won't attract the best new people into the business. We won't attract the best clients to work with us. We want to attract the best supply chain. So there's a big cost to not engaging in this. And just to give you some indications of, you know, so that, and that's why we see this as a holistic piece. And just to give you some indication, as we sit here today, I think 48% of my fleet of about 1,400 cars is either electric or plug-in hybrid. In September, we banned the purchase through of any new car, which is either hybrid, petrol or diesel for anyone on the car scheme. So, of course, actually, that saves petrol and diesel costs, which at the moment are, yeah, that's a saving to the business. We, of course, use virtual technology where we can to save people traveling around the country as part of our smart and agile working policy. So there's lots of things that we can do, which actually are real steps forward, and which are, yeah, so our carbon footprint on our fleet is now, I think, 67 grams per kilometre. A few years ago, it was 133 grams per kilometre. That will be down to 25 grams by 2025. And we said we'll be at net zero for our own operations by 2030. So making good strides on carbon reduction, making good strides on social value, working with local supply chain. And that, again, it's a really important measure. So a lot of our clients, one of the things that they measure when they're assessing tenders, it's not just about price. It's also about what social value will you give back to the local community. It's about the quality of your balance sheet, the quality of your people. What's your decarbonisation strategy? These things are actually important in tendering for work. So that's all very important. And then, of course, we're working really closely with our clients. So increasingly, we're seeing the need to look to design buildings which will be maybe net zero carbon in operational use. Of course, looking at the embodied carbon, the carbon through to demolition is more complicated, but we're looking at that with our clients as well. So we're looking at this holistically. We've rolled out this month a e-learning course to all of our staff. So everyone in the business is now literate on this whole decarbonisation agenda. We've appointed a low carbon construction manager in the business to work with our clients to design carbon out of our schemes. Again, working with our clients. So lots of things that we can do. And as I say, and then there's that opportunity in that green retrofit. 80% of buildings, Sarah, that will exist in 2050 when the government wants to be at net zero. 80% of those buildings already exist. So the only way the government can hit net zero is to make those existing buildings more carbon efficient. And there's a real opportunity for us to help in that on that journey as well. So yes, there are costs, but I think the bigger cost is not engaging in this at all.
I didn't know that 80% of the stock that we're going to have in 2050 already exists. And green retrofitting, that's a new one in my investment lexicon. Trevor Phillips asks, which Galliford Try buildings, projects are you most proud to have been involved with? And that doesn't necessarily have to be a backward-looking statement. It could be.
So you know, over the years, we've done some high-profile projects, but the ones I really like are the ones where you go. So I was at Alderhay Hospital in the autumn, where we've just built a new facility for, effectively, for teenagers. And that's a fantastic facility. When you go and look around some of the schools that we build, and we typically build 30 or 40 schools at any one time on the ground, ranging in size, tiny nurseries up to big secondary academies. When you go and look at those schools, you can see the impact and the environment that we've built for people to learn in, compared to, you know, probably what you and I learned in and compared to what was there previously, is just fantastic. So it's those kind of real community, you know, projects that will really make a difference in the community. I think that, you know, you go and look around those and you come away proud of what our people are doing and proud of the legacy that we're leaving behind.
I'm going to need a bit of help with some abbreviations here. It's okay. A question from Robin, who says, your EV is close to zero. Is the market concerned you'll not be able to pass cost increases onto your largely public government customer base?
Okay, so no, I don't think that's the issue, Robin. So what Robin's referring to is our market capitalization, as you said, just over £200 million. My average month-end cash is £180 million in the period to December, so relatively small enterprise value. I think, Robin, we've worked through a period since we demerged the business 2 years ago in 2020. Obviously, we had a big share churn through 2020 and through COVID, and we've worked our way up. And our share price actually has performed, if you look over the last month, 3 months, 6 months, over the last year, has performed relatively, you know, well. I mean, clearly the shares have been struggling through the with the horrendous events over in Eastern Europe, and our share price has actually worked well. So what we're about is making sure, don't forget, we only put our new 5-year strategy out in September. You know, and it's about us making sure that people understand the strategy, understand that we can progress forward. We're effectively a new business. This is, you know, we've been trading without house building for 2 years. We've posted profits in December 2020, in June 2020, now December 2021. And we're building that track record of delivering what we said we're going to do, delivering against our strategy. And I think that delivery, Robin, alongside the dividend, is what will drive the re-rating. So that's what we're looking for.
In terms of that 5-year strategy, which was published last year, I'm assuming it's a living document and that you can tweak it, because, of course, we would never, ever have predicted what has happened over the last 28 days on a global political scale.
Yeah, of course. But what we're seeing, so actually at the moment, of course, what we've done is tweak it upwards in terms of the dividend, Sarah. Yeah. And remember, our focus is on the margin improvement, that margin up to 3%. We've deliberately used the words revenue towards 1.6 billion. If revenue ended up at 1.5, 1.7, I'm pretty relaxed about that, so long as it's good, profitable growth, which generates bottom line growth and generates dividends for our shareholders. So, you know, so we're not going to chase revenue for the sake of revenue. We're going to grow revenue because the markets are there to support it. And we're still seeing good pipeline of opportunities in healthcare, you know, in education, across the other public sectors, sectors that we work in.
So I've been reading some market research notes, my favourite type of reading, in terms of your dividend, which you keep mentioning. Estimates suggest, this is from the market research note, Mark Watson Mitchell, estimates suggest that dividends will rise from 5p last year to 6p this year, 7p next year, and then up to 8 pence per share in 2024, meaning that the attractive yield will be more than twice covered by earnings. 8p per share, 2024, is that a conservative estimate?
Yeah, I don't think that's conservative. I mean, I think when you look at the potential, and actually if you look at the some of the research which came out after we published the half years, they increased some of those dividend per share numbers, certainly for the current year as well, as we improved that dividend policy. So yeah, remember, we're growing our revenues up by 50%, our margin by 50% as well. And what that translates to is a larger growth in PBT. And it's that growth in PBT, of course, which will drive the dividends at that 2x cover. So we are seeing, you know, I'm not going to commit to a dividend number on this. My board would not thank me for that, but we absolutely see dividends growing through that strategy period. Absolutely.
And it's worthwhile, I think, reminding the viewers and the listeners that you are institutionally backed. There's an awful lot of them. I won't test you, but there is Premier Miton, Standard Life Aberdeen, Hargreaves Lansdowne. So I'm wondering what the percentage is between institutional backing and the retail investment that you have at the moment, or that you want to have.
So we have, so our biggest shareholders are institutions. They are active funds. So we meet with those shareholders, you know, and very grateful for their support. We also do have a good a proportion of retail investors, which is why it's so important to, you know, for me to spend time on forums like this as well. So yeah, we've got an excellent share register, very pleased, but of course always welcome new shareholders to the fold as well.
So you spoke about a re-rating there. To me, it's a bit of a dirty word in the investment world. Do you not think you're already there in terms of market perception?
Well, I think, as I say, we've been on a journey. So since we demerged the business, you know, we're a very different business, effectively a new business than we were 2 years ago. You know, and I think there is a period where actually it's important to demonstrate a track record, to show that you can deliver the profits and the regular sustainable profits that you've said that you're going to do. And that's the process that we're working through. The business is in excellent shape. It's got this, you know, strong balance sheet. It's got, you know, really good performance, really good set of contracts across the business. And you know, then the onus is on us to, you know, to make sure that we tell that message and we explain to people how we're going to deliver the strategy that we set out last year.
And thank you for coming on my forum again. It's always a pleasure to see you, Andrew Duxbury, Finance Director of Galliford Try. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Sarah. Thank you.